it's been kind of struggle to explain why economics modeling is so hard to, especially to people with natural science background. So I've been struggling with it for a while, and then my friend popped up one problem which kind of illustrates the difficulties of economic modeling. So let's imagine the government comes to you and says the moon is shifting away from the Earth. It's going to cause lots of disasters, and we have a great idea. Let's put rocks on the rockets and let's fly them to the moon, and that probably can stop the moon from shifting away. Now, if you're a physicist and you are not allowed to use any equation at any number, like, what advice you can give to the government? See, as soon as you take away equation and you take away numbers, you immediately, even in natural science, you get kind of like economics problems. You start having Keynesian, you start having free marketers, and you can start arguing it to infinity. So having equations, having the numbers, keeps discussion on the kind of level in the playing field kind of clear. So that's why we are trying to do modeling in economics, we're trying to put numbers, we're trying to put equations into things that seems to be obvious, but you can also argue until infinity is exactly opposite problem. Those two completely opposite political sides, they were wrong. They both were wrong, but they were both wrong for different reasons. By the way, the guys who also were arguing about speculative access, they were also wrong because they were targeting the usual suspects, which were actually driving the price down. So if the government actually go and intervene into the market and they would shut down those guys, the price would even jump even higher. So that's what you kind of see in a lot of economic related policy making, that supposedly good intentions can often come with very undesirable, very bad outcomes. So that's why, again, that's why we're trying to find out what we can do about it, what we can, how we can put a number on it, how we can come up with more or less reliable models for that. Okay, so this is a very basic description of the most useful tool we have in economics. And why I put it here, it's really very basic. You basically start studying economics with this equation. Because I want to stress that this equation was not particular to economics. This equation is known under many names in many different disciplines, and it was actually first formulated in 1937. So imagine that you want to hit like Osama bin Laden, but you don't know where he is. That's what happens in economics, right? You don't have a boundary condition, that's a huge problem. And you can have possibly many, many, many infinite number of solutions for this. So what I want to stress here is that economics problems get really complicated really quickly if you try to solve them directly without any sophisticated method. If you say that your problem is so complex and so hard to solve, it doesn't mean that your problem is actually good. Means that maybe you're doing something not very smart in your problem. And just imagine that if you have such a high dimensionality, some people would swear by parallel computing, bit computing. And imagine that you can speed up your execution by using 10,000 grid points, 10,000 computers by 10,000 times. That's 10 power of 5. 10 times 30, that doesn't help you a lot. I mean, it's still a lot more than computational power that computation power can afford. Now, again, I want to stress this point that your problem has to be specifically good for a particular way of computing. That there is no free lunch theorem in computing as well as in economics. You cannot get much mileage out of any computational method unless your problem is specifically formulated to take advantage. This is a thousand-year model of costly insurance of entrepreneurial risk based on Greenwald-Jovanovich model that we are trying to put into some policy, kind of making policy advising use. So here what we did for Mexico recently with Luke Hyman and Joaquin Moreno. So we're using this model, we modeled the development in Mexico from 1998 to 2006. The other outcome of the small risk, so-called policy function. It's basically the decisions that people make. What's interesting here is that if you never join the financial system, you save a lot. because you're not insured against those shocks, so you have to save more. Those are actual data compared to model hypothesis and model prediction, and those are actual growth in New Mexico. And here we try to estimate the effect of government policy in Mexico of 2000 to 2006. You have to be really careful with those government intervention. You can see some of faster growth, but you can also see some of bigger disappointment when something that you expected happened didn't happen. And here's some of the modeling I did for this paper, John Falcon and Falcon. It's a very good paper. I hope it will be published very soon. So those black lines are the roads in the Lopburi province of Thailand. It's kind of a good province. It's a very wealthy province. Well, not very wealthy, but it's relatively more wealthy. And here we see the statistically significant growth of entrepreneurship in the area over a 10-year period. And we see kind of interesting picture here. It's not that entrepreneurship growth is completely stopped. No, there are still some areas, but they are not exactly, they are kind of related to the areas that is credit expansion. And you don't see this huge, like big blue drops. It's kind of more average stats. But you don't see also the growth, this very intensive growth of entrepreneurship in some areas. Oh, by the way, if you're interested in how it compares to real life, that's the actual data. That's the actual data. What's beautiful about those models is that, I mean, it's really dumb to run the model with, you know, the result already beforehand. It's interesting when you run the model, you get some results that make you think of what's going on. So those are countrywide. This is the same kind of modeling, but only done not for the provinces, but for the whole country. Why I'm showing this picture is it's a very beautiful illustration of what if you get computer output for all those entrepreneurs kind of entrepreneurship level. You see this huge pile of numbers, and it's there. How many? If you model at Tambon level, it's more like a region, small province. It's a sub-province. Level like 6,000 of them. So you have 6,000 outputs, okay? So you have 6,000 numbers from the computer. How we make sense of them? What is it in the random noise? How to make sense? Now, when you put them on the map, on those same numbers, you can suddenly see some kind of patterns. Maybe you imagine these patterns, but they still kind of make much more sense if you just have the raw numbers. So that's why, again, I want to stress this part when you have to connect your model, your computation, and your output. They all kind of have to link together to make policy making sense. And here, just the next stage of what we are doing right now. Is trying to use more advanced computing tools, especially blue-green and argon. And what we're trying to do next is kind of this more advanced model, which will combine highly parallelizable approximate dynamic programming. That's the approach that I really like. And then this recent algorithm for computing for competitive equilibrium with heterogeneous agents, which was originally put in place by Francisco Boyer and Shin. And we combine that, this branch of research coming from Professor Townsend, lotteries approach to moral hazard, solving moral hazard in investment. We don't really know all the social consequences of the work we are doing, especially in economics. You really have to be really careful that you try to explain as much as, even if you like your results very much and you want to push them, and you want to go to policymaker and say, look, my policymaker, that's a model that makes a lot of sense. That my results are really good, and you have to modify the policy basically. You really have to be a little bit careful with that, and you have to exactly make explicit really what's the assumption and what's your program is. So that's really, I think it's really important.